I can see a hello from Dr. Hala Sharif. We've got panelists from Egypt and Iraq and neighboring countries. So we've had really good attendance with regards to the quality of people attending. So welcome to this, our 14th session. We are coming to the end of our series. Next Saturday is the last. Thank you to Organization for Rare Diseases India, which has encouraged this platform, and to AOCN, which has symbiotically with ORDI made this possible, and to all our speakers. Every single session, we've had fantastic speakers. So we welcome this particular session. So I'm handing this session on to our moderators, who are fantastic pediatric neurologists in the field in India. I welcome Dr. Vail Murugan, who is an experienced pediatric neurologist who was trained in the UK, finished his disability training from the UK, and was working in Chennai, in Apollo Chennai, and currently is based mostly, he does outreach clinics still in Chennai, but is currently based in GKNM in Coimbatore, and his own center, Hope Child Neuro Center, and has done a lot of work, publications, and things like that, both managerial and otherwise. So that's Dr. Vail Murugan, and Dr. Ramesh Honanki, who again is one of the early people who started off pediatric neurology and is well known in the field, trained in pediatrics and his DM pediatric neurology from AIIMS, and is part of the pillars of Rainbow Hyderabad, is interested in stroke, neonatal neurology, and neuromuscular disorders, and has multiple publications in more than 50 publications in index journals and chapters. So I'm handing over both of this to our able moderators. So welcome to the session.
Thank you, Anne. And thanks to ORDI for giving this wonderful set of sessions. And I have learned a lot from this. If we can have the slide for Dr. Asha Thomas, please. Yes. It's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Asha Thomas, who's now a pediatric radiologist at Baptist and trained in 1992, the same year I came out in CMC Vellore, and then did the post-graduation and also in CMC Vellore, and then did a fellowship in pediatric radiology at Westmead Hospital, Sydney in 2009 to 2011. And now is the head of the department of radiology at Bangalore Baptist Hospital. And we're really looking forward to hear about your discussions with this one. I'm sorry, I think I just got caught up somewhere. We're very much looking forward to hear from her. And please start, let's not waste any time. Thanks.
Good evening, everyone. Are you able to see my screen?
Yes, yes.
Okay. So the topic that I have today is the Listen Carefully Pachygyria Spectrum Disorders. So Listen Carefully literally just means smooth brain. And absent gyri can be normal in the human brain till about 4 months of gestational age. Diagnosis antelatally can be made, but it is difficult to make this diagnosis before 24 weeks. So this image over here is the ultrasound image at 22 weeks. It's a fetal scan. And you can see that the brain actually looks quite bald. In a sense, there's no gyri here, just the beginnings of the sylvian fissure. So at this stage, it would be really difficult to call Listen Carefully. Whereas this image is at 28 weeks, and you can already see the gyri and the sulci forming there. So antenatal diagnosis is difficult, but is possible after 24 weeks. So before we go into the topic, I'd just like to say a few words about how the cerebral cortex is formed, just a little bit of the embryology. So basically, there are three steps that happen towards formation of the cerebral cortex. The first is proliferation of the neuronal stem cells, which happens at the periventricular region. And then the second step is migration, and thirdly, the organization. So once these cells actually proliferate, they migrate towards the cortical plate, and then they get organized into the cortex, which is a six-layered cortex. So these three steps don't necessarily happen one after the other. They all happen together. And so today, my topic would be mainly dealing with problems in migration, which will be the reason for the listen carefully pachygyria spectrum that we're going to look into. So malformations due to abnormal neuronal migration. So under this category, we have three groups. And the first two groups are what I will be dealing with briefly. Heterotopias, I'm not going to go into details. So this the first group is the listen carefully or subcortical band heterotopia spectrum. So this is the first group. And what we know as listen carefully one comes into this group. And the second group is the cobblestone complex, which is also listen carefully two. So we'll go to the first one, which is the listen carefully subcortical band heterotopia spectrum. Now, under this, there are further types. And the first one is the classical listen carefully or type one. And then you also have listen carefully with agenesis of the corpus callosum, listen carefully with cerebellar hypoplasia, and listen carefully not yet classified. We look at mainly the first type, type one or classical listen carefully. Now, listen carefully type one, that's the first type, is again a spectrum. So here you have the agyria, and then you have pachygyria and subcortical band heterotopia is the end of the spectrum. So in between, you can have combinations of agyria and pachygyria, and similarly, combinations of pachygyria and subcortical band heterotopia. So this whole spectrum actually comes under this listen carefully type one. So we just look at some examples with the radiological appearance. So this, if you look at this image, this is a T2 weighted axial image of the brain. This is one of our patients here that we had in Baptist. So what is striking is the total lack of gyri. And you can just about see a very shallow sylvian fissure here. And this has a classical appearance, what we call as a figure of eight or hourglass appearance. And the cortex is extremely thick, as you can see, extending from about there to there. A very thin white matter and a prominent ventricle here. The pathology here in the listen carefully type one is under migration. Remember, we had talked about the problems with migration. So the cells do not migrate far enough out into the cortical plate. So we have a very thick cortex. So this is the same patient. This is a T1 weighted image here. And you can see, again, the same findings, a thickened cortex, white matter, which is quite thin, and that's the ventricle, the shallow sylvian fissure. Now, the normal cortical thickness ranges from 3 to 4 mm. So you can see how thick this is. And in the spectrum of that we're looking at, the cortical thickness can vary from 12 to 20 millimeters. So this is a coronal image of the same. Again, the same findings, thick cortex, thin white matter. And this patient also had some a heterotopia, nodular type of heterotopia as well. As you can see, there's some gray matter within the white matter. So just to illustrate this further, this is a normal brain T2 weighted image. And this is the agyria image that we just looked at. So in the normal brain, if we consider this line as the edge of the ventricle, from there to there is white matter, predominantly white matter, and you have this well-organized six-layer cortex over there. And that's exactly what we see here. We see the ventricle ending there, and you have this whole thing here is white matter and just a thin layer of the gray matter there. And whereas in the agyria pachygyria example, the agyria example here, if this is the edge of the ventricle, the white matter extends only from here to here. So very thin layer of white matter, and this whole thickness is occupied by the gray matter, which instead of being six layers is actually now four layers. So apart from that, you can also have enlarged ventricles, which we saw, and you can also have abnormalities of the anterior corpus callosum. So there is also a grading for type 1, listen carefully, which I have taken from this article. So this is a very busy slide, unfortunately, but I'm not going to go through this whole thing, just to illustrate that this grading starts off, it's a 1 to 6 grading, starts off with diffuse agyria and ends with subcortical band heterotopia. And in between, you have pachygyria over here. And you can also see grade 2, grade 3 have a mixture of findings like agyria with a few shallow sulci or mixed agyria, pachygyria, and so on. So it's basically following that same spectrum that I showed you. The grading just goes from agyria, which is considered to be the most severe, to subcortical band heterotopia, which is considered to be the least severe. So grade 1, grade 6. And in between, we have different combinations of findings. So we look at another case here. This is a 1-year-old child. This is a T2-weighted image, axial image at the level of the lateral ventricle. And the finding here is that we are seeing gyri, but very few and thick gyri that we are seeing. And this is just a normal brain to compare with. Now, if you look at this image, other than the fact that there are thick gyri, or this is a case of pachygyria, we can also see that there's a pattern here. If you look carefully, you find that there are fewer gyri posteriorly. I hope you can appreciate that. There are more gyri anteriorly, although this is not normal either. There are fewer gyri posterior. So the involvement is more severe posteriorly. So that is the pattern. So this is a case of pachygyria with predominant involvement posteriorly. And there is even a stretch over here which looks almost agyric over here. So this is the same patient. This is a T1 weighted inversion recovery sequence. And you can see, again, the thick gyri, the very shallow sulci. And again, you can notice a difference between the anterior and posterior gyri and see how there are fewer gyri posteriorly, almost tending towards agyria posteriorly. Now, this is another case. So in this case, the moment you look at it, you know, yes, this is also pachygyria. But you can see that the involvement is just the opposite as what we saw in the previous case. So here we find that the gyri are few and very thick, and involvement is more predominant or more severe anteriorly as compared to posteriorly. And this is the T2 weighted image where you can see gray matter extending from there to there, white matter, thin sliver of it, and similarly on this image as well. So at the other end of the spectrum, we talked about subcortical band heterotopia. Now, the pattern that you see in subcortical band heterotopia is a very classical pattern. And if you look at this T2-weighted image first, you find that You can see cortex, which almost looks, in terms of thickness, looks like a normal cortex. And after that, just deep to that, you see a thin strip of white matter. I hope that can be appreciated. And then you see a thick layer of gray matter, followed by another layer of white matter. So it is kind of an alternating gray-white pattern. And you can see clearly on the T1 weighted image as well, gray followed by a thin layer of white matter, a thick band of gray and white matter. So this thick band of gray is actually the subcortical band heterotopia. In terms of the gyri, there are gyri, but you can notice that the sulci are rather shallow. And the Sylvian fissure is just about a little notch over there. This is a subcortical band. It's an important pattern to recognize and know. So I've just put those three together just to get that kind of a summary of that spectrum. So you have agyri on the one extreme, and you have subcortical band heterotopia at the other. Pachygyri in the middle, and in between you have different combinations. You can have different combinations of these. Now, I have just taken a few images from this journal simply to show the different patterns and combinations of findings that you can have. Now, each of these are different patients. So we look at the first top row first. This represents, it looks, is agyria, as you can see, and the second image is agyria as well. Now, if you come to this image, you find that there are a few gyri anteriorly, and so there's pachygyria anteriorly, and posteriorly looks pretty agyria. So it's agyria here and pachygyria. So that's the combination that you're finding here. And in this image over here, this patient, these are all different patients. So here you have a few gyri here. So that's pachygyria, and pachygyria posteriorly as well, but with more severe involvement posteriorly. Similarly, if you look at this patient, this is a straightforward agyria, and this is agyria as well. Now, if you look at this patient, it's anteriorly almost no gyri at all. So anteriorly agyria and posteriorly pachygyria. And in this patient, this is a case of pachygyria, but you can notice that the involvement is more severe anteriorly. The gyri are thicker anteriorly than posteriorly. So when we talked about the types of the listen carefully subcortical band heterotopia, we talked about listen carefully with certain associated findings. So these cases that I'm going to show you are again taken from this article here, which are associated with certain findings. For example, here, this is a T1 weighted sagittal image. And you can notice that the cerebellum is hypoplastic. And the axial scan of the same patient shows agyria. So this was a patient with agyria and cerebellar hypoplasia. This patient, on the other hand, the midline scan actually looks quite normal, with the normal cerebellum and midbrain. And whereas the axial scan shows agyria. So this was a case of agyria with no other associated abnormalities. So this patient, if we look at the T1 weighted sagittal image, looks pretty normal. The midline structures look normal, with a normal corpus callosum, cerebellum, midbrain. But when you look at the axial scan at the level of the ventricles, you can see that there is pachygyria, and the involvement is more severe anteriorly rather than posteriorly. And this is the same patient, a scan taken slightly higher. And you can see again, pachygyria, more predominant or more severe involvement anteriorly rather than posteriorly. Now, this patient, if you look at the T1 weighted sagittal image, again, if you compare it with this one, you can see that the corpus callosum is missing here. So this is a case of agenesis of the corpus callosum. And if you look at the axial scan here, the T2 weighted axial scan, anteriorly, and actually I have this enlarged on the next slide. So if you look at it anteriorly, you have this, pachygyria pattern. You see thickened gyri. But as you come posteriorly, I hope you can notice that we start seeing a different pattern where we see gray, and white again. So we have posteriorly, we have subcortical band heterotopia going on. Whereas when you go anteriorly, it's pachygyria. So this patient actually has a combination of pachygyria, which is anterior, and subcortical band heterotopia, which is posterior. So these cases I just showed, just to show the kind of combinations of these different disorders that you can get. So with that, we come to the listen carefully type 2 or the cobblestone complex. So unlike the type 1 that we looked at, the pathology here is that the neurons fail to stop migrating. So in listen carefully type 1, neurons where the pathology was under migration, whereas here it's more like over migration. So the neurons fail to stop migrating and move right up into the subpile space. And then you end up with a disorganized cortex, unlayered cortex, which has this kind of a lumpy, bumpy appearance. And that's where we get the name cobblestone complex. So here's an example of listen carefully type 2. This is a CT scan. And you can see that the gray matter is thickened. And so it extends from here to here. And the sulci and the gyri are few. Sylvian fissure is shallow. And you have this lumpy appearance of the cortical surface. And this is the scan taken at a higher level. And you see the same appearance, the lumpy, bumpy appearance of the cortex. Now, if you were to compare it with, listen carefully, one or agyria, you find that both of these can have a little bit of a figure of eight appearance in the sense that the Sylvian fissure can be shallow in both. However, the main difference, and both have a thickened cortex here, but the main difference is the absolute smooth brain here. Here instead you have this kind of a bumpy appearance that you're finding. So this is also a case of listen carefully too. In this case, you can see that the cortex is not actually as thick as the example we saw previously. And it can, so the thickness of the cortex can vary. It's actually almost normal thickness here, whereas in some areas, like here, it's thickened. And if you look at this level, you can see this kind of a disorganized cortex where you have gyri and sulci, but you find that the sulci are rather shallow and the gyri are disorganized, and you get this kind of an appearance. Now, apart from that, with cobblestone complex, you most often have a lot of white matter abnormalities also going on. In this case, you find that the white matter is extremely hyperintense. So hypomyelination is associated with this condition. And in this case, the ventricles are also enlarged. So there are a whole lot of findings in cobblestone complex. So like we just saw in the cases, the sulcation is reduced. Cortical thickness can vary. The main important thing is that you get this bumpy or pebbly cortical surface. And associated findings are hypomyelination of the white matter, like we just saw. And you can have brainstem and cerebellar abnormalities as well. So now listen carefully, type 2 or cobblestone complex is further classified. And here, basically into two categories, the first being congenital muscular dystrophy syndromes, and the second were syndromes with no involvement of muscle. So the first one consists of the Walker-Warburg syndrome and muscle ibrain and Fukuyama congenital muscular dystrophy. So I have one example which I have taken from a journal here. This is a case of listen carefully two with muscle ibrain disease. And what we're seeing here is a few gyri here, which are broad, not very thick, though the cortical thickness is not very much. And you can see that posteriorly there are more gyri here. The white matter is extremely hyperintense. And this patient also has other findings which go with the muscle ibrain disease, where there is a hypoplasia of the pons and there are cerebellar cysts as well. So when you come to differential diagnosis for listen carefully, pachygyria spectrum, when it comes to the type 1 or the listen carefully subcortical band heterotopia spectrum, the appearances are quite classical. There's not too much of a differential diagnosis in that spectrum. But when we come to type 2, I think the main differential diagnosis here would be polymicrogyria, because in polymicrogyria, you can have thickened cortex that looks disorganized and that looks lumpy. And the second differential diagnosis could be listen carefully 1, although with careful examination of the case, probably most often be able to differentiate between listen carefully 1 and 2. So this page, this image is a T2-weighted axial scan of the brain, where if you look at the cortex from here to here, you find that it's thickened. We are losing the differentiation between the cortex and the white matter here. And if you look at the surface of the cortex here, you have this bumpy appearance over here. So this was actually a case of polymicrogyria. But you can see how that this can be a close differential for listen carefully type 2 or cobblestone complex. The difference here is that polymicrogyria is usually regional in the sense that it's usually in one particular area. And here in this case, it is in the perisylvian region, which is a favorite place for polymicrogyria. And if you look at the rest of the brain in this case, you find that the cortex is absolutely normal. The gyration and sulcation is absolutely normal. So that is one of the main ways to differentiate between cobblestone complex and polymicrogyria. Cobblestone complex also usually has white matter abnormalities like we just saw, and may have a lot of other associated abnormalities. Whereas in polymicrogyria, involvement may usually be only in one area. So that would be the main difference between the two. So I think I've come to almost my last slide here. Yeah, when I was actually preparing this talk, the words that came to my mind were spectrums within spectrums. You know, when I actually learned about agyria or pachygyria as a radiology resident, which is way back, I learned it as a single entity, and agyria was smooth brain with no sulci, and pachygyria was thick gyri, and that was about it. But now we know that there is much more to be learned and known about these conditions. But I think, you know, we need not get lost in all this classifications and grading. I think the important thing is, especially for us radiologists, is when we see a case of anything that comes into the spectrum, is to look for patterns and associations. For example, if you are reporting a case of pachygyria, we could just report it as pachygyria and end it there. Or we could look for patterns and associations. Like, for example, is that pachygyria, is it uniform anteriorly and posteriorly? Is there a predominance? Is there any associated finding? Is there corpus callosal agenesis or cerebellar hypoplasia? To look for those things, to know that these things can coexist, and to look for those things and document them, I think that would be the important thing in helping to make the diagnosis. And I have not discussed genetics at all in my talk, because our next speaker will talk about genetics in detail. But yes, that's all I have. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Dr. Asha Thomas. That was an excellent one. It just described it as simple as possible. And we couldn't really thank you enough for this, but we think there will be a lot of questions there, and already a few of them have come up and which you have answered to. So I will move on. The questions will be taken at the end. Can we move on to the next presentation, please? And Dr. Ramesh Konanki will be introducing Lokesh, who know, well, everyone knows him still. It'd be nice to introduce him.
Yeah. Good evening, everyone. Thanks, ODI. Thank you, Anne, for having us here. This has been a wonderful series of lectures for most of us pediatric neurologists to get the updates on many of these neurological problems. So now I invite Dr. Lokesh. I take pleasure in inviting him. He is my colleague. For last 10 years, we have been working at the same center. And he's a pediatric neurologist at Rainbow Children's Hospital, Hyderabad. And he trained in neurology at NIMHANS initially, and then did fellowship and subsequent training in Bristol, UK. And he is quite passionate about genetic aspects of many neurological problems. And to his credit, many of us now know the mineralizing angiopathy as a new mechanism of stroke. And it was Dr. Lokesh that identified in some of the patients very early, and subsequently it was published, and that has been a landmark study. And he has a lot of publications in index journals, and is quite a passionate teacher as well. Over to you, Dr. Lokesh.
Thank you, Ramesh, for that kind introduction. Thank you, ODI, Anne, and AOCN. So, is the screen visible?
Your presentation is, yeah, it has come now.
Yeah, okay. Thank you. So, we'll have 30 minutes.
Yeah. Yes, yes.
Yeah, okay. So at the start of this week, I had a consultation. This is a mother we had seen almost 8 years back. The parent, this time there was no child, only the parents came, and the mother was in a devastated state. The diagnosis was lissencephaly. So there are no scans brought by the parents. It was the file, old file, which was there. And the reason they were there for the consultation was after the child died at around 10 years of age, the mother went on to Google, started reading. She felt that there are some information which the mother's ill health or not feeding well during the pregnancy might be the cause of lissencephaly. So she felt devastated. She lost her sleep, stopped eating for 2-3 months. So the father got worried. And then brought the husband got worried and brought the mother for consultation. So it just tells that it's so important to understand, just explaining, although we may not be able to make a difference, just explaining, yes, these structural problems, you don't have anything in your hand. It is nature, which is that, and that's the genetic causes. Although you may not identify the genetic etiology in almost 60% of these structural brain malformations. But explaining, even you can't identify on the genetic testing, but it is still a genetic etiology that clears, takes off a lot of burden on these parents, as we had just the starting of this week. And so I think as a neurologist or a clinician, that's one of our important responsibilities. And we have a lot of exciting things we have understood, but a lot of things we still don't know. So I just acknowledge all my collaborators on this talk, the neuroradiologists, Dr. Nihal, Dr. Shayan, Dr. Ravi Verma, neurology, Dr. Ramesh Konanki, our trainees, Dr. Surbhi and Dashrath, and the genetics, Dr. Tenral and Dr. Ramprasad. This is a slide borrowed from Dr. Nihal. I think Dr. Asha has gone through in great clinical details, all these things. So we're looking at genetic causes of lissencephaly, subcortical band heterotopia, polymicrogyria, polyverticular nodular heterotopia, if time permits, FCD. And also I'm just going to look at the microcephaly and megalencephaly as well. So outline, we'll try to include microcephaly, macrocephaly, lissencephaly, pachygyria, agyria, SBH, and complex cortical malformations, tubulonopathies, periventricular nodular heterotopias, polymicrogyrias. I think the list is quite long. I'm not sure how much I'll be able to try and cover, but we'll try to do a quick run through. So the microcephaly, macrocephaly are usually in the first 3 to 4 months, so that is a neuroblast proliferation stage, whereas other ones are in the migration stage between 3 to 5 months, they have their origins. We'll skip this. Microcephaly have a very varied etiology. As we are clinicians and the radiologists, we know it is not a single diagnosis. It can be coming with a syndrome. It can have various other complex associations. So I think we need to look at whether it's a syndromic association versus a non-syndromic. Non-syndromic is something like microcephaly vera. And within this, they can have a completely normal looking brain, or many of them can have mild pachygyria as part of the microcephaly. And all of us have seen the child who is 12 months old, who has a head circumference of 38, 39 centimeters running around, having a good eye contact, but they will have significant speech delay and cognitive issues. But motor wise, they might do very well. So the most of the common genes which are involved in microcephaly, primary microcephaly, almost 10 of them are associated with the function of the centrosome. Some of them with the ciliary motility, and some of them with the nucleolar function, and some related to centrioles and the ciliary membrane remnants. All this in red are the structures which are associated with microcephaly. Abnormalities, abnormalities of these structures, any of these genes can cause microcephaly. So this is a list taken out from the study by Jayaraman et al. So I've just reordered according to what is our information we have, the etiology for the microcephaly. ASPM gene is the commonest gene in our series. It's a Indian information, I think, contribution from all of us pediatric neurologists and geneticists who have sent the samples for microcephaly evaluation, where we have found the ASPM gene is the most common in the Indian scenario, which is a centrosome related gene, followed by, we have a different gene in the series I'll show. The third most common is WDR62, and then you have CEP135 followed by MCPH1. So if you look at the first three common ones, all of them are centrosome related genes. Only the MCPH1 is the one associated with DNA damage response and regulation of chromosome condensation. So it is a sort of DNA repair pathology which can also cause. Other than the centrosome related, nucleus related, other common pathology structure which is associated with microcephaly would be your DNA repair disorders. I think this is very clear band out. Microcephaly, spastic diplegia, and you have photosensitivity, your diagnosis is going to be a DNA repair disorder. They have very severe failure to thrive. And this is children with cocaine syndrome. So the DNA, these are all the genes linked to microcephaly that are proteins involved in DNA repair. So you can see there are a lot of genes which are associated with DNA repair are associated with microcephaly because they cause excessive neuronal death. The first category centrosome where there is less of mobilization of the neurons. The second large group where there is a lot of DNA repair disorders causing neuronal death and microcephaly. So these children have far more pathology as compared to the previous group of etiologies. So this is a list of 97 children we were tested. This is the data from MedGenome Lab. And ASPM was the most common gene, accounting for 30%. PCNT gene, which is also called microcephalic osteodysplastic primordial dwarfism. Here, I think you have more than one handle. Other than microcephaly, you have a primordial dwarfism. Some of them are associated with cerebral aneurysm. That was the second most common thing. That might be the reason why it has come up high here as compared to other studies. WDR62 accounting for the third most common. And the MCPH1 is the fifth most common gene. The ASPM is the abnormal spindle gene associated with microcephaly, which is essential for normal mitotic spindle function of embryonic neuroblasts. Whereas WDR62 is expressed in neuronal precursors undergoing mitosis, and it's very extremely important for cell proliferation, spindle organization, and mitotic progression. So just to re-impress that ASPM is the most common, followed by PCNT and WDR62 in our population. So we go to the megalencephaly without cortical malformation. So you're not looking at the conditions where there are some structural leukoencephalopathy and other things without major cortical malformations. They can have prominent VR spaces. The common ones can be autosomal dominant macrocephaly, benign ones, NF1 and Cowden are the other things which can be commonly seen. So this is a child, as you can see, has a large forehead. He had broad hands and feet with frontal bossing, and he had height and weight which was more than the 97 centile. Head circumference was also more than 97 centile. Unfortunately, because of the large head, he had HIE grade 2 spastic all four limb involvement. MRI brain showed multicystic encephalomalacia, but the clinical phenotype is of a Sotos syndrome. So this is one of the common associations. It's a clinically diagnosable cause of megalencephaly. This is another child who presented with severe autism. You can see these lumps and bumps here, the small lipomas, subcutaneous, in different angles. Hope you can appreciate these things. And he also had slightly large head, open mouth. And here the diagnosis was PTEN mutation, also called Cowden syndrome. So the megalencephaly related genes in 60 of these children tested, NSD1 was the common. Once again, I think the phenotypic characterization is quite easy and clear for most of the initiated geneticists and neurologists. And 10 mutation was seen in 18.3% of them, and rest of them contributed to other mutations, including CCND2 and other mutations. So almost 80% of these megalencephaly genes were related to NSD1 and 10 mutations. Then we'll come to lissencephaly and subcortical band heterotopia, which Dr. Asha has clearly described in detail. I'm not going to go through the details of the radiology. So this is a child, 4 year, 6 month old, who is, has epilepsy, which is well controlled on 2 medications, who has expressive speech delay. She is independent for her activities of daily living. She is able to walk around, understand simple commands. So this is the MRI of the child. As you can see, there is a significant Pachygyria, probably some parts there is Egeria as well, frontally dominant. And the corpus callosum is normal. Brainstem is looks fine. Cerebellum also, there are no abnormalities. So this is the T1 weighted images, which shows the similar findings. So I think this was shared by Dr. Ash already. So you can have such gross looking structural abnormalities, but the children can at times perform quite well. The various genetic mutations which Dr. Nihal suggested for this are actin related genes, DCX, KIF5C, and the LIS1 gene. So if you have posterior dominant Egeria Pachygyria complex or LIS encephaly, you are looking at LIS1 gene. If you have anteriorly severe Egeria Pachygyria complex, you are looking at DCX mutations. That's usually what is seen. So this is a very busy slide, but I think it's a very useful slide if you go through systematically. If you have diffuse Egeria, look for any cerebellar dysplasia, dysmorphic basal ganglia, and brainstem abnormality. If it is not there, then you are very likely looking at DCX in male and LIS1 in both male and females that can be seen. If you have any evidence of diffuse Egeria along with cerebellar dysplasia, dysmorphic basal ganglia, brainstem abnormality, you are looking at tubulinopathies. So if you have profound cerebellar hypoplasia along with diffuse Egeria, you are looking at CDKF5 mutations. But if you have a subcortical band heterotopia, very likely you are looking at DCX mutation, usually in girls. And if you have Pachygyria Egeria complex with anterior dominance, then once again DCX and actin mutations are seen. Also, if you have cerebellar abnormalities, RELN pathway and VLDLR, these are the two things which are closely linked, which cause both hypoplasia of the cerebellum along with Egeria Pachygyria complex. Whereas you have the same Pachygyria Egeria complex but posteriorly dominant, you are looking at ARX mutations. And if you have regional or focal Pachygyria, look for intracranial calcifications. If you have intracranial calcifications, it could be secondary to CMV. If you don't have intracranial calcifications, it can be due to KIF2A mutations. So these are sort of microtubule associated motor proteins. So both the dynactin, dynein, and kinesin are microtubule associated motor proteins. So there are various things which have very important role. Any of the abnormalities can lead on to these severe structural abnormalities. So what are the genetic variations which we have found from the Indian population? So this is almost 34 of the 63 children tested. 35% of them had LIS1 gene, DCX was in 17%, tubulinopathy, TUB1A in 15%, and other ones all constituted few of the cases. So the commonest one is LIS1, followed by DCX, followed by tubulinopathy and NDE1. This is the distribution in the Indian population, what we have seen, where we have had a positive response. PCH with non-lobulated vermis, yes, if there is a malformed cortex, then we are looking at VLDLR and RELIN mutations and DAB1. Whereas the cortex is normal, then it can be MAB21L1, COFG syndrome. So once again, as earlier mentioned, the pattern recognition is going to be important. So if you have Pachygyria, as you can see here, along with severely hypoplastic cerebellum, you are looking at either VLDLR or RELIN mutations. So RELIN mutations also cause similar significant cerebellar hypoplasia and Pachygyria. So it's a good handle there. This is a child who had a developmental delay. And as you can see, the midbrain is dysplastic. The thalami look very prominent and the basal ganglia complex are not very well formed. So you start thinking whether it is tubulinopathy. Even the anterior limb of internal capsule is not very well seen. So you have abnormal midbrain dysplastic deep gray nuclei. And this child had a PCBH12 mutation, which is a diencephalic mesencephalic junction dysplasia, which was the cause of this structural abnormality. So LIS1 gene, usually it's de novo, either deletions or mutations are seen. And more severe in the posterior brain regions, as already noted, 60% of patients with posterior to anterior isolated LIS1 carry genomic alterations in LIS1. So that's a reasonably good hint. And simplified chiral pattern in the posterior brain with underlying SPH, usually you can find mosaic mutations in LIS1 gene. Whereas Miller-Dicker, usually you have associated structural facial abnormalities in the form of prominent forehead, bitemporal hollowing, and a short nose with upturned ears, and protuberant upper lip can be seen. This is because there is a contiguous gene deletion in 17p13.3, and 12% of these are inherited from a parent who carry a balanced translocation. So if you have actin-related mutations, there is a syndrome called Barrister-Wintle cerebrofrontal frontofacial syndrome, which is associated with pachygyria and with anterior posterior severity gradient. And they have characteristic facial features. This is taken from an article from Brain. One of the important handle for this actin-related gene mutations with pachygyria-igaria complexes, many of them have a very short corpus callosum. That's a good handle along with the facial features. So molecular genetic testing, if you are looking at the Miller-Dicker syndrome, you request an array CGH analysis. If you are looking at isolated lissencephaly, LIS1 mutation or DCX based on the posterior to anterior gradient. So all reported LIS1 mutations are generally de novo mutations. And couple with a child with LIS1 is usually given a 1% chance of recurrence in next pregnancy because of gonadal mosaicism. Boys with severe pachygyria and frontal lobes, you request sequencing of DCX gene. But if you have a subcortical band heterotopia, direct sequencing of DCX should be performed. If that is negative, then MLPN needs to be done. For DCX mutations, proband's mother should be tested. If they are carriers, then there is a 50% risk of recurrence. If they are not carriers, then there is a 5% risk of recurrence. But if you have lissencephaly with cerebellar and brainstem hypoplasia, tubulinopathies account for around 30% of this, which are heterozygous missense mutations, which due to their dominant negative effect, they cause these abnormalities. There are many other genes associated with lissencephaly, cerebellar and brainstem hypoplasia. And only de novo heterozygous missense mutations are seen, except in TUBA8, which can be autosomal recessive. Whereas DCX mutations usually cause lissencephaly in males and subcortical band heterotopia in females. And most cases of diffuse subcortical band heterotopia are due to mutations in DCX. So in summary, if you are testing for lissencephaly, Miller-Dicker, RACGH, isolated LIS1, lissencephaly, LIS1 or DCX. Posteriorly, you are going to ask MLPA first, then LIS1 sequencing. And anterior to posterior gradient, DCX sequencing, then MLPA for the X-linked ones. If you have periventricular nodular heterotopia, FLNA sequencing is generally done. Going through cobblestone lissencephaly, as we know, the limitation is the glial limitans membrane is disrupted, and the apical radial glial cells, which instead of stopping at the glial limitans membrane, go beyond into the subarachnoid space. And there they cause the lissencephaly, and because cobblestone lissencephaly, because of this space is subarachnoid space is occupied by the cells there, they are also associated frequently with hydrocephalus. So this is a child who presented with motor more than cognitive delay, slightly large head, not megalencephaly. And the MRI showed diffuse symmetrical white matter changes, brainstem abnormality, hypoplasia of the cerebellum, vermis. So, and also had a CPK, which was in the terms of 3000. So we were thinking of congenital muscular dystrophy, merosin deficient. But the genetic mutation came LAMA2, which was pathogenic, merosin deficient, as we thought clinically. But also it had another mutation, which was likely pathogenic, which was in the dystroglycanopathy spectrum. So how do we differentiate them? Go back and look at the radiological pattern in the two. The child didn't have any eye abnormalities. And usually in the dystroglycanopathies, you have much more severe brainstem abnormalities. Cystic spaces can be seen. And your cerebellum also show cystic changes. Whereas in LAMA, this is the classical thing what we had in our index child. So it was more likely a LAMA2 mutation in the index child. I think I'll skip this pathology slides. So muscular dystrophy, dystroglycanopathy spectrum, FKRP gene was the commonest one. The second common one was GMPPB, followed by POMGNT and POMT1. These are the common mutations what we had seen in the 163 patients associated with muscular dystrophy, dystroglycanopathy spectrum. One of the interesting presentation of the lissencephaly with absent corpusculosum and ambiguous genitalia is X-linked ALG or ARX mutations. So the interesting thing here is they have very early neonatal onset epilepsy syndrome. This is because the ARX is predominantly expressed in the ganglionic eminences, which actually contribute to the development of inhibitory interneurons rather than the radial glial cells. So the inhibitory interneurons are disrupted in ARX. That is why the inhibition, the excitatory neurotransmitter levels will be high, the GABA will be low in ARX. So as compared to other forms of lissencephaly, the ARX associated lissencephalies, they cause postnatal microcephaly and very severe neonatal onset epilepsy. That will be a very good handle along with ambiguous genitalia, presence of hypoplastic corpus callosum, plus or minus hypothalamic dysfunction. And they have very severe outcome. They mostly die within 1 year. Although it's not a common form in our population as well. I think there are only 2 cases in our series. So we'll quickly go through the tubulinopathy. Tubulinopathies, they are very important structures, microtubules and microtubule associated protein along with the dynein and the microtubule associated motor proteins. I'll not go into the theoretical aspect of them. So they have very important function in mitosis, organization of intracellular structures, axonal pathfinding and neuronal migration and protein transport. They lead on to multiple cortical malformations, anomalies of white matter and cranial nerve abnormalities as well. So these are the microtubules. They are associated with DCX function, Lisfranc function, dynein and kinesin. They are all a complex. So any abnormalities in this complex give rise to significant structural abnormalities. So the microtubule associated abnormalities, because of impaired axonal pathfinding, they have hypoplastic or absent corpus callosum, asymmetric brainstem, fused striatum. Because of impaired mitosis, they cause microcephaly. Because of impaired neural migration, they cause asymmetric basal ganglia heterotopias and cortical dysgenesis. They can also cause fibrosis of extraocular muscles and hypoplastic olfactory nerves. This is the spectrum. They can cause lissencephaly, simplified gyral pattern, microlissencephaly, polymicrogyria-like cortical dysplasias. These are the various spectrum, classic lissencephaly, and central predominant pachygyria can be seen. You can have lissencephaly with agenesis or hypoplasia of corpus callosum. Very extensive spectrums can be seen. I'll just skip that. So there are a lot of publications on genotype-phenotype correlation within the tubulinopathies. So there are various lists. I'm not going to go through the details of it. It will be available for your reference, the presentation. This is the same thing which has shown the genotypic phenotypic correlation. And the inheritance, predominantly most of them are autosomal dominant, except ABA8, which has autosomal inheritance reported. Most of them are de novo, 95% heterozygous pathogenic variants. If a parent is affected, likely a somatic mosaicism can be seen in the. So this is a 2-year-old child with developmental delay, motor more than cognitive, with mild cerebellar signs. What you can see is dysplastic ventricles. We cannot, anterior limb of internal capsule is not seen even at 2 years, and fused striatum. You have a dysplastic brain stem. So this combination and hypoplastic corpus callosum, this combination usually points towards a tubulinopathy, and this child had TUB3 mutation. So this is a child with TUBA1 mutation with similar pachygyria, centrally dominant pachygyria. This is a child who presented with spastic diplegia. He has significant, cognitively is quite alert and active, but a significant spastic diplegia. And if you look at the MRI, there is hypoplastic brainstem, anterior limb of internal capsule is absent, fused striatum, a tubulinopathy, and irregular ventricles, asymmetric irregular ventricles are seen. This is another classical form of tubulinopathy with the developmental delay, spastic diplegia, and speech delay, but the MRI showed significant cerebellar atrophy, hypomyelination, and this is a classic tubulinopathy, which is easy to identify radiologically. It was a hypomyelinating leukodystrophy type 6. So the complex malformations, when we looked at the tubulinopathies, the common ones were the TUB4A, which accounted for 55%, TUB3 for 22%, and TUB2B of 10%. Other kinesin associated were one each cases. How much time do I have, Ramesh?
Maybe another 5 minutes.
5 minutes. Okay, I'll quickly see how much we can cover. Neuronal heterotropias, there are three main groups of heterotropia: periventricular, subcortical, and leptomeningeal. So these are the periventricular nodular heterotropias, which are seen in this child. And they are usually, they can present with intellectual delay, some with refractory epilepsies. And some of them can have such large heterotropias. We have one child on follow-up for last 4 years. He had 2 febrile seizures. He doesn't have any other abnormality except for the speech delay. And the epilepsy is well, seizures are well controlled on a single medication. So although the abnormalities might look very gross, but sometimes the outcomes might be reasonably quite good. So this is bilateral periventricular nodular heterotopias here. So the most common mutations which are associated with this kind of bilateral periventricular nodular heterotopias are FLNA gene, filamin associated gene. So generally it is seen in women, it is lethal in the boys. But there is a case series reported by Dr. Girish and Anju from Mangalore, the group of genetics, along with the international collaboration. What they found is there are a group of boys who had this periventricular nodular heterotopias. You can see here, this is taken from their publication. And they have abnormal bones, long bones. Along with that, clinically, they have this skin which is quite elastic, increased sandal gap. All these manifestations were seen, and they had pathogenic mutations in the FLNA. So this is because these mutations are hypomorphic missense mutations, which are distal in nature, truncating or mosaic. And so that's why these boys are live born and they survive longer as well. And these are secondary to FLNA mutation. Generally, we say they are prenatal lethality in males. So PNH genetic basis is X-linked, and almost 100% of families have this with that kind of extensive bilateral periventricular nodular heterotropia. They carry the FLNA gene mutations. And as we discussed already, prenatal lethality in males, but in rarer, milder mutations, the boys can survive. These FLNA mutations are large actin-binding phosphoprotein, which stabilize the cytoskeletal formation, and they are responsible for focal adhesions along the ventricular epithelium. So I think these are some of the images. I'll skip them. Other form, which is ARFGF gene, which is rare autosomal recessive protein. And this is it may assist in transport of FLNA to the cell surface. So this can also contribute rarely to the periventricular nodular heterotopia. So if you have to do genetic analysis for PNH, classic bilateral PNH, FLNA mutation sequencing. If you have microcephaly significant with PNH, do ARFGF mutations. If you have other brain malformations or extra neurological defects, do RACGH. And in among carriers, about half of them have de novo FLN mutations. So I think this one is double cortin mutation, DCX. Coming to quickly to polyglia, one or two slides. I think this is a child with one of the proven polyglia mutations, polymicrogyria mutations. She has hemiparetic gait, epilepsy, which is well controlled. She had GPR56 mutation, which is a spectrum where if you can see the clinical indications for developmental delay, hypotonia, and our MRI brain showed diffuse polymicrogyria, hypoplastic pons, cerebellum was also hypoplastic, dysplastic cerebellar folia. So the clinical suspicion was, although congenital muscular dystrophy, I think it was an interpretation issue of the MRI, but she had all the features of a textbook description of GPR56 related polymicrogyria. This is the polymicrogyria, ventriculomegaly, which is seen in these children. There is cerebellar cyst and atrophy can be seen in this. And you can have varied hypoplasia of the corpus callosum and dysplasia of the brainstem can be seen in GPR56 mutations. And dysplastic white matter also are part of the GPR56 mutations. This is another child with polymicrogyria secondary to paroxysmal disorders. So the polymicrogyria can be due to paroxysmal disorders, various genetic disorders, tubulinopathies, microtubulinopathies, and even COL4A1 related mutations can also give rise to polymicrogyrias. So if you are looking at genetic analysis of polymicrogyrias, bilateral frontoparietal perisylvian, you look for GPR56. With severe congenital microcephaly, look for WDR62 or CATN-B1. If you have polymicrogyria with microcephaly or normal head size, TUB2B and DNCH1. But if you have large head, then you are looking at either PIK3R2 or P13K-AKT-MTR pathways, which is part of your TSC spectrum. 15% of all patients with bilateral perisylvian polymicrogyria and megalencephaly syndromes, they have mutations in these areas. So polymicrogyria related genes in the 69 children, almost 50% of them were due to GPR56, what we had, and 25% of them were due to LAMP2 mutations, and FIG4 mutation was seen in around 12% of population. These are all data from Indian population. Hemimegalencephalies are usually associated with various syndromes. I think that if they're non-syndromic, it's difficult to diagnose, but a lot of syndromic associations are known, which is listed here. So it's a huge teamwork while managing these children with multiple cortical dysplasias. I think we have learned so much more while working with a well-trained neuroradiologist. I think our knowledge of geneticists, genetic etiologies of these conditions and management and counseling has significantly improved with all these associations. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Lokesh. That was quite illustrative, and I think Although we know identification of individual genes and knowing about them, but it helps really to know the epidemiology, like which genes are more commonly identified or which mutations are common with each type of malformation. That really helps to focus our investigations rather than going sequentially one by one. I think that's very helpful. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
There are a lot of questions. Probably we'll take at the end of the third talk.
Sure. Yeah.
We'll move to our.
Sorry. I'll stop sharing. Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
So, yeah, Dr. Vail.
Yeah. Thanks, Ramesh. That was quite really it's gone on so well so far, and. Next, I have the pleasure of welcoming Dr. Sneha Sudhakar, who is a consultant pediatric neuroradiologist at Great Ormond Street Hospital, London. And she was a former professor of radiology at CMC Vellore. And in the slide itself, you can see the number of presentations which have come through for papers from her on PubMed. And her main clinical and research interest is neurogenetics, neuroinflammation, neurooncology, and fetal imaging. And this talk is going to be on posterior fossa malformations, which always confuses me a lot, particularly when it is really a proper PCH, or is it just a mild cerebellar hypoplasia, or is it really a cerebellar hypoplasia, or just a worming hypoplasia, and what to do and how to identify that. And really looking forward to hear from you, Dr. Sudhakar. Thanks. Please take over.
Thank you, Bill. I hope you can see my screen now.
Yes, I can.
Yeah. Thank you. So first of all, I thank the organizers for this invite, and it's a really good initiative to have this educational series. I'm very happy to be part of this. Some advancing issues again, sorry. Okay. So today we look at the normal and abnormal anatomy of posterior fossa. Look at some of the cystic malformations that Dr. Vail was saying about how to differentiate the numerous malformations and confusing terms that we often see. We'll also see some other cerebellar malformations, and most of this will be a pattern recognition approach. So on one side of the panel, we have a normal cerebellum. That is, all these three are normal posterior fossa images. Whereas on the right side, you have abnormal posterior fossa pons as well as the cerebellar images. So one thing which I always feel is that attention to detail is very important, and you need to know your normals to identify the abnormal. So we'll look at some of the I think there is a problem with the animation. So as you can see on this sagittal image, looking at the pons, the midbrain and the medulla, the pons should be at least 1.5 to 2 times in the craniocaudal dimension as compared to these two structures. Whereas in this, you can see that it is not so. The pons is quite small. And the base of the fourth ventricle is a straight line, as you can see in this. Again, it is not a straight line. You can see a small bump here. And the vestigium, which is this point here between the superior medullary velum and the inferior, it has to be really sharp and acute, and it roughly corresponds to the midpoint of the pontine craniocaudal dimension. Here you can see that it is slightly shallow. And coming to these axial images, the cerebella foliae are usually parallel to the calvarium. So this dark line is the calvarium. You can see that the cerebella foliae are oriented parallel to the calvarium, like an onion peel in the normal cerebellum. Whereas on this side, you can see that they are oriented, not parallel, in different orientations. And this is the coronal T2 image, where again, the fissures should radiate towards the cerebellar nuclei, as you can see here, all of them radiate towards the cerebellar nuclei. Whereas on this image, you can see that they are not oriented uniformly towards the cerebellar nuclei. So everything on this side, which we saw, all these features has to be looked at on every single image. And if we can find a pattern and give a diagnosis, it is good, but always try to describe as much as possible as a policy, because you can always do a reverse phenotyping, and that's how we learn. So this one, just an exercise of what we saw. So this looks pretty normal. Maybe the pons are slightly small. Anything else that, so it, again, so it may look normal, but you can see that the posterior aspect of the pons is not a straight line, and it is concave here in the inferior aspect. And this was a case of Moebius syndrome. So it is absence of the colliculi that causes this appearance. Here again, you can see that the midbrain, the pons, and the medulla, maybe it looks relatively normal, but again, look at the vestigium. It should have been very sharp. And here you can see that the vestigium has a sharp angle, whereas here it is quite shallow. And on the axial images, you can see that this entire cerebellum is quite dysplastic. This is an unproven case of cerebellar dysplasia. So if you were to go to the genetic or embryology of the cerebellar and the posterior fossa development, it's quite complex. As you can see, it is different genes come into play at different stages of neurodevelopment, and it is quite a complex event. So we won't have time to go through all of this, but you can see that how it correlates with the imaging. For example, in this case, as we saw, this is not a normal ratio between the midbrain pons and the medulla. You can see that the midbrain is quite, especially the tegmentum is very bulky and also elongated. And the cerebellum is also abnormal here. So this was GBX, whereas this one on the other side is a large tectum and a small cerebellum. Here the cerebellar size altogether is okay and the tectum is small. So here you can again see on either side of the isthmic organizer, you can see that the PAX is on the superiorly and the GBX is inferior to the isthmic organizer. So that is what is reflected in this different segmentation patterns of the brainstem. Apart from these, is dorsoventral patterning of the brainstem. Another thing which can cause isolated brainstem malformation is, as Dr. Lokesh was saying, the tubulin genes and the axonal guiding genes, which affect the axon guiding pathway. So this is a RoBO3. It is a recessive gene, and all of us know that they usually present with horizontal gaze palsy and progressive scoliosis, and it has this characteristic appearance on the MRI with this pontine cleft, dorsal pontine cleft. Usually they have normal supratentorial findings, and this is again to say that different genes and different pathways come into play in the posterior fossa, brainstem and cerebellar development. Another case from the literature, this is from the literature. Here again, you see that there is almost complete absence of cerebellar development or cerebellar agenesis, as you can see. So this again is a PTF1A mutation, and you can see that these PTF1A, it is very important in the migration and development of the GABAergic neurons. And we also know that they present with diabetes and cerebellar agenesis, and their prognosis is very different. Sometimes they may not have much of cerebellar symptoms, and which is surprising, but sometimes they do have significant cerebellar and brainstem related clinical symptoms. Again, showing that how knowing the embryology, you can sort of correlate it with the some of the imaging findings. Another important distinction that we sometimes have to make on imaging is, when you see a small cerebellum, is it a hypoplastic cerebellum or an atrophic cerebellum, or is there something else going on? So the two images that you see, this one is a hypoplastic cerebellum, because the cerebellar, normally the cerebellum should extend from the intercollicular line. So this is the superior colliculus, this is the inferior colliculus. It extends usually from the intercollicular line or the base of the inferior colliculus up to the orbix. So this is the orbix, which is the area where the fourth ventricle continues as a central canal. So it should normally extend from here up all the way down to the orbix. So clearly the craniocaudal dimension of the cerebellum is less in this case. But if you notice that the foliae, interfolial spaces of the CSF spaces are not widened here. Whereas in this case, again, the cerebellum is small. It does not extend to the intercollicular line or the orbics, but you can see that the foliae are separated and there is a lot of atrophy of the cerebellar parenchyma. So this is a case of isolated hypoplasia in the sense there is only hypoplasia in this, and here you have atrophy. So cerebellar hypoplasia, if it is a pure cerebellar hypoplasia, there is no progression over time. This posterior fossa can be normal or small. It is just that the cerebellum looks normal, but it is a small and a compact cerebellum. Whereas atrophy is usually progressive and enlarged cerebellar fissures will be seen. But all these things are not true if the process starts in the prenatal period, before the cerebellar development is completed, and we'll see some examples of that as well. So if it is an isolated cerebellar hypoplasia, as you can see from this slide, it is a lot of different disease spectrums and diseases which cause it. It can be posterior fossa malformations, other genetic syndromes, infections, and even metabolic disorders. So this is very difficult to radiologically to say what it could be, but then we always apply the panels and the other clinical and biochemical clues can help us come to the final diagnosis. So this again, if you see, this is at 11 days of age and this is at 11 years of age. Is this normal? Not quite, because you can see that on superiorly, the cerebellum vermis does not quite reach the intercollicular line. And so this is a small cerebellum or a hypoplastic cerebellum, you would have called it at 11 days. But you can see that at 11 years of age, the this looks more like an atrophic cerebellum. So this is what happens in the prenatal onset degenerative disorders like pontocerebellar hypoplasia and CDG, where the onset is prenatal, the cerebellum does not quite develop to its full extent, causing hypoplasia. And also because of the degeneration, which is progressive, you'll see features of atrophy. So pontocerebellar hypoplasia is quite confusing term. So we'll look at some cases and try to figure out how do we make sense of this. So again, you can see that the pons is small, the cerebellum on the vermis is not, the size seems to be okay. On the coronal as well, you can see that the vermin size is preserved, whereas both the cerebellar hemispheres are small in size. Supratentorially, there's a lot of white matter volume loss because you can see the ventricles are dilated. There is hardly any deep white matter between this ventricular surface and the cortical surface. And on this axial image, you can also see that there is a peculiar contour of the brainstem. It has an egg-shaped or butterfly-shaped appearance here. So this is the T1 coronal. Again, you can see this appearance where the vermis is maintained or even larger, whereas the cerebellar hemispheres seem to be quite small. And the dark thalamus, which is probably reflected, related to the extensive white matter changes, is also seen there. And this is what you call as the dragonfly cerebellum, where the vermis is preserved and the cerebellar hemispheres are small. You have a small pons, they have the PVL-like of appearance, where the lot of deep white matter is gone, and the figure of eight midbrain is also seen. So this was a case of PCH9, AMPD2 mutation. So that is the thing with PCH, that they can have small pons, they can have small cerebellum, they can have other findings, which, for example, this one really mimics like a PVL kind of appearance, at least in the supratentorial white matter. This another case, again, you can see that there is small pons, the cerebellum is also small, but on the coronal, you can see that the vermis as well as the cerebellar hemispheres are equally involved. So this is called as a butterfly pattern or the globally small cerebellum as opposed to the preserved vermis that we saw in the prior case. Again, the same case, same mutation. You can see that pons is small, the cerebellum is also small, but the supratentorial on whatever is available, it seems to be not quite affected. The corpus callosum seems to be okay in size. And this is a CASC mutation. So pontocerebellar hypoplasia, is it a descriptive term or is it a nosographic entity? So that is what is confusing about this term. So we use it interchangeably for both. So this is the PCH. As you can see, there is so many different types described, 14 types described, and each of them have some subgroups as well. So this are mostly RNA related genes, whereas if you notice this article from 2020, they have taken the view that it is more of a descriptive term, and they have included in the infratentorial and supratentorial abnormalities they've looked at, they've included a whole lot of other genes which does not come under the nosographic entity. So I think the pontocerebellar hypoplasia is a descriptive term, but you have to also remember that some of the other findings which we saw will help us sometimes to diagnose this specific RNA-related PCH entities as well. Again, you can see that it is not necessary even in the pontocerebellar hypoplasia to have a small pons or a small cerebellum. Pons is relatively spared and preserved in all these conditions, and cerebellum can be preserved in a PCH10 as well. So it's a spectrum even based on the imaging findings. This is another article which is quite nice and which we have to update on genes and subtypes. A good read again on pontocerebellar hypoplasia. So this is a pontocerebellar hypoplasia which they have proposed as a PCH14. The additional findings in this case, again, you can see that between this group of patients, there is a whole lot of heterogeneity in the imaging appearance, whereas here the pons in the cerebellum are very small, whereas in some of these, it looks like the findings are quite subtle. What is common in the supratentorial is this small size of the caudate nucleus and the putamen, as well as some hyperintensity involving those structures. So they have proposed that this to be included as a PCH type 14. Another case, as you can see, it looks quite similar to what we saw earlier. This looks like a dragonfly cerebellum with the relatively preserved vermis and very small cerebellar hemispheres. As you can see, this pericerebellaceous space is quite widened. Again, you see a lot of white matter volume loss, and corpus callosum is quite thin in this case. But that is why it is important to know, as a radiologist, the clinical profile. This child was 30 weeks preterm and had no progressive symptoms. So this can mimic the prenatal, the preterm findings, including because we know that the cerebellum completes its development in the last trimester and as well as postnatally, if because of the preterm delivery, this cerebellum has not reached its full potential, and also there could be hemorrhages and all the sequelae which is associated with that, and which gives the mimics the appearance of the PCH entity. So again, you can see on this panel that there is unilateral cerebellar, the small cerebellum. And you can also see that it looks like there is a clastic appearance and something is destroyed kind of appearance. So again, if you go back to the fetal MRI of this patient, you could see that there was some hemorrhagic changes in the cerebellum. So this is a disruptive prenatal origin hemorrhage, and usually when it occurs in the 18 to 24 weeks, you can get such an appearance. So just to remember that unilateral cerebellar small cerebellum can be most commonly is a prenatal disruptive process. It can be an acquired process, but it can also be a genetic cause, as you can see here. So this is a COL4A1. It is a vascular gene. So there can be a lot of hemorrhages there, both supratentorially and infratentorially. And in this case, you can see that there is hardly any cerebellum, but you can also see the T2 hypointense areas there, suggesting that there has been a lot of hemorrhage. This is the KRA2, which is a disappearing cerebellum because the cerebellum goes down and it gets mechanical damage, and it can become progressively small. This is a CMV. CMV similarly can affect the cerebellum significantly and cause hypoplasia, as well as more malformations of migration as well. So in terms of whether a cerebellar malformation is acquired or genetic. This is a beautiful article. The senior author on this being Dr. Dobbins. So it's a must-read article for everyone. So what they did is they looked at cerebellar hypoplasia and Andy Walker, roughly 57 and 40 cases. And they found that the Andy Walker, they couldn't find the genetic diagnosis in most of the cases, like more than 80% of them had no pathogenic variant identified in even very in-depth whole genome sequencing. And they even looked at the single cell and RNA sequencing. They could not find anything. And only 16% returned a genetic cause, whereas the cerebellar hypoplasia had a half of them had some genetic etiology. And they also found that some of these genes were in the mostly expressed in the vascular and the neuronal genes were the most involved in these conditions, which means that some of them, which is like unilateral disruption, unilateral or asymmetric or something, can also be a vascular gene. So the disruption which we talk about can be either a genetic cause, an ischemic cause, an infective cause, or other acquired causes like toxic causes as well. So it has to be kept in mind. And unilaterality, asymmetry, clefts, heterotopia, again a finding which people say indicate some acquired nature if it is seen as a single heterotopia, like for example here, a couple of heterotopias here and there. This was also a child with a lot of prenatal risk factors. And again, hemorrhage. If you see hemorrhage, always look for hemorrhage if you see a unilaterality or asymmetry, and that could be a clue that it has something to do with a disruptive process. So in this, the first one was Dandy Walker. The second one was FOXP1 gene. This was a hypoplasia, whereas these two had significant risk factors. And they also describe the small cleft that you see in the cerebellum, again, a finding which suggests a disruptive etiology. So we talked about Dandy Walker. So this is these are the two posterior fossa appearances that we see. One is a large posterior fossa, with the vermis is rotated and it is very, it is not formed well, as you can see. And you can see that you can hardly see the vestigial point. Here you can see a sharp vestigial point. Here, this is the presumed vestigial point, or you cannot even identify the vestigial point here. And the vermis is significantly rotated. The fourth ventricle sort of opens into the retrocerebellar CSF space, as you can also see on this axial image. Whereas on this, you can see that the vestigial point is relatively well preserved and the posterior fossa is not enlarged in size. There is an infracerebellar cystic space. And so on the axial, it looks like there is a contiguity, but we'll also see, one more slide, but you can also notice that both of these cases have hydrocephalus. So, again, the things that we were saying. So this is a Dandy Walker malformation. And you can see in detail what happens here. So you can see that, again, like a very small vermis, which is significantly rotated. You can see that this lobule here is unpaired lobule and also this tail-like structure. So this is a tail of the Dandy Walker. When you see a tail and an unpaired lobule, Dandy Walker is very likely the diagnosis. There are also some advancements in the vermis is not maybe mildly rotated, but the vestigium is present. The fourth ventricle is dilated inferiorly, but there is a normal posterior fossa, and this was a Blake's pouch cyst. Both can have hydrocephalus. You can look at the vermis. We can also look at some of the recent advancements that a couple of papers published. Let us look at the choroid plexus and the tela choroidea. So in this case, you can see, so this is the vermis here, and you can see that this is the choroid plexus and the tela choroidea, which is quite separated from the vermis. That means this is a parasagittal cut, so it is not the typical sagittal cut like here. You can see that the tela choroidea is separated from the vermian edge by a large distance. So this is reflected, this is what the embryology is like. So the Dandy Walker is due to the persistence of this anterior membrane. And so you can see how the vermian edge will be separated from the choroid plexus here. Whereas in Blake's pouch cyst, you can see Again, the vestigium being quite okay, and the choroid plexus being at the edge of the vomus. So this is again a significant clue to differentiate the two. But the vomus will be quite hypoplastic in an antibacter, and we also saw that the tail as well as an unpaired lobule will help us identify the structure. And it is also said that you don't even need to have a large posterior fossa sometimes, or even a ballooned fourth ventricle. If you have these findings of a very flattened vestigium, a distance between these two, you can still consider it a Stanley Walker. But one of the important things that we want to note is that, so this is from the literature, you can see this is a FOX C1, this is a FACE syndrome. Both show Dandy Walker-like morphology. So the important point is that Dandy Walker is again a phenotype and not a diagnosis. It is similar to your cerebellar hypoplasia. So it doesn't stop there. So it is just a phenotype. And as we noted, we don't even know how many of them have a genetic basis. So when we look at the lobules, it is important to know that the different lobules and their arrangement so that you can identify them on the image. And T1 SPAGE image is the best for that. So here you can see that, again, continuing with the posterior fossa cyst, you can see a retrocerebellar cyst, which causes some indentation, but the vomus is fully well-developed, very sharp vestigial point. And this is just a megacisterna magna. This is an arachnoid cyst. I know that these things are not very straightforward when you actually see a case. So you can be descriptive. And if you see something like the specific things which we mentioned as a very flat vestigium, seriously rotated vomus, or the distance between the choroid and the vomian edge, you can diagnose. Otherwise, you can remain descriptive. And also, even in Dandy Walker, it is not the vomian development that correlates with the clinical severity. There are a lot of other things. The same group has looked at that, and they seem to think that this not the clinical severity does not correlate with the vomian extent of vomian hypoplasia. So I think as we are understanding more about this, till then we can be quite descriptive in these terms. So isolated vermin hypoplasia can be there. Again, we have talked about this, that it is, there is a host of other things which can, different syndromes where you can see this. And you can again see that there is a little bit of widening of the fourth ventricle. The tegmental vermin angle is a little bit wide, but the vermis is quite well formed. And so both of these are just mild cerebellar hypoplasia, and then you go ahead with the panel, and again, there's only a 50% chance that you'll find something. Cerebellar cysts in the parenchyma. So these are three different scenarios. As you can see, there is cerebellar cysts with a normal, relatively normal cerebrum, and a dysplastic fourth ventricle. As you can see on this, the shape of the fourth ventricle should have been something like this. Here you can see it is mediolaterally elongated. And this was a case of Lama 1. And this one here, both Asha and Lokesh have talked about it. It is a congenital muscular dystrophy. And this was also looked at. This is a GPR 56. So just three examples of cerebellar cysts. This is another Aunt Minnie, as most some of you will recognize. So you can see that the pons is small, but also there is a bump along the dorsal aspect of the pons. This is pontine tegmental cap dysplasia. They also usually have severe internal acoustic meatus stenosis. And if you look at the diffusion weighted imaging, you will see the what has caused this bump, and also the complete loss of the normal arrangement, which is the control here. As you can see, that the on the case, you can see that there is displacement of the major tracts, the corticospinal tracts and the transverse pontine fibers. Both of them are displaced and abnormal in this case. And you can also see the the bump which you see here. And it may or may not be directly connected to the MCP as well. Another definite diagnosis that you can make on, a descriptive diagnosis that you can make is the rhomboencephalosynapsis, that you can, sometimes it can be so subtle that you may miss that unless you look for it specifically. You can see here that the cerebellar hemispheres are combined together. They are not separated by the midline vermis. Again, on the coronal, you can see the similar appearance. That is the foliate are contiguous here. And as you know, this specific, when this finding is associated with alopecia in the parietal region, you know that this is a syndromic and it is this vermis locus Hernandez syndrome. Again, we haven't found many genetic variants in this syndrome. So as you can see, again, the control, you can see that the normal vermis should be there. And here again, you can see the contiguity of the two cerebellar hemispheres. Another ontomany is the Joubert syndrome, which is causing the smaller tooth kind of appearance. And on the sagittal, you will see the straight and very thick superior cerebellar cistern, superior cerebellar peduncle. And again, on the DTI, you can see that there is normally the decussation of the superior cerebellar peduncle, which is all crossing fibers are seen as red. Here you can see this red dot is the decussation, which is absent here. And the corticospinal tracts also can be uncrossed in the Joubert syndrome. And we know that there are more than 35 genes identified and a whole lot of other non-neuronal findings as well. And the multi-organ involvement sometimes allows you to, as a radiologist, we should always look for the other findings and then clinch the diagnosis. But the Joubert syndrome is quite, has a classic imaging appearance. Both my previous speakers have talked about it. Just to show you the posterior fossa abnormalities, you can see the significant dysplasia of the cerebellar hemispheres. You can see superiorly that the foliae are oriented in different directions. You can also see the dysplastic brain stems, so see the small pons. However, the diagnosis is made by this classic appearance, and this is a tubulinopathy again. Another ontomany, this cerebellar appearance is very classic for this condition when associated with hydrocephalus as partial callosal dysgenesis and this medially oriented bifrontal cortical malformation. So this is the Chatelain-Mekelle syndrome, GPSM2 mutation. And another ontomany which we can diagnose on the imaging if you see the constellation of findings along with the deafness. So that was our most of the cases. So we talked about the normals. We talked about how acquired cases should be, acquired causes should also be considered, and also looked at how to differentiate some of the cystic posterior fossa malformations. And when we think that we know most of things, we will get a googly like this. So this is the child had dysplasia of the cerebellum in fetal ultrasound, and an early scan was done because of that. So you see that there is a lot of unilateral cerebellar hypoplasia. You can see almost a clastic kind of appearance on the left cerebellar hemisphere. A cleft is also seen here, whereas the right cerebellar hemisphere seems to be relatively well preserved. You also see that on the ADC map, which is the this is the diffusion. You don't see it much here, but if you look at the ADC, you can see here there is a little bit of more hypo intensity, which means, as you know, that it can be, you use this sequence for stroke, but it also indicates that there is high cellularity. So that was a finding which was overlooked, rightfully so, because the diffusion does not show much of it on this first image. But when the child came back at 10 months, you could see that this left cerebellar hemisphere, it shows a huge mass lesion. And now you can again see that there is some diffusion changes. This is slightly more dark than the contralateral normal looking parenchyma. So this was a medulloblastoma of extreme nodularity. So at this point, we would have thought that the most likely diagnosis is a disruptive process, a congenital, an acquired cause of unilateral cerebellar disruptive process, but we have, again, we can see that how this could have been because SHH is quite important in this external granular layer migration. So, and SHH we know is involved in the medulloblastoma. So this could be the connecting link between the two. And there are other cases noted in the literature as well. So essentially we are still learning and we have a long way to go before we make sense of this posterior fossa malformations. So some of the take home points is know what is normal and you will know what is not. This is very important for the radiologist because you really need to, and it is very difficult because in a child because of the different appearances at different stages of development at ages, but we have to familiarize ourselves with what is normal for each age. Attention to detail, as I was saying, is very important, and cerebellar atrophy versus hyperplasia, it's sometimes quite difficult, but if you can, it is very useful in further managing, further guiding the diagnostic pathway. Always remember the genetic and acquired causes can sometimes have overlapping features, especially in the posterior fossa. Posterior fossa cysts keep updated. For example, the Dandy Walker malformation, the criteria probably are going to change. And also the notion that it should be again considered as a phenotype is also not very popular. So keep updated by reading the new articles and thought processes that come up. Detailed clinical profile is very important because before we could diagnose on the imaging, many of you neurologists would have already had the diagnosis because there may be a clinical feature which is quite pathognomonic. And also a request for all neurologists to give us a detailed clinical profile because we'll be able to give you a much informed report if that is done. So the motto is to keep learning and maybe more important to keep unlearning as we, you know, continue on this journey of revealing more and more genetic underpinnings of these diseases. Some of the useful resources and articles, and I acknowledge Dr. Felice, Dr. Mankat, and all my CMC and GOSH neurology and radiology colleagues and teams. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sudhakar. I think we'll probably open up for questions. Some of the points you mentioned were really enlightening, and I still would struggle getting to be able to look at all those differences which you have pointed out. We have made all the notes, but the problem is I don't think this would be that very obvious when we look at the films. It's probably best to look it up on the desktop and go through it in a little bit more detail, and without that I don't think we'd be able to. And one of the things we run into trouble regularly is the reports which come up with without all this information, and they would just post it as normal, and we are the ones who are caught out, and very often it is the white matter hyperplasia which is always attributed to HIE full stop, and we have to really tease out all the finer details. Ramesh, shall we start up with the questions, and we can probably start throwing it around to...
Sure. I think Dr. Lokesh is not here, isn't it?
I'm there, Ramesh.
Okay. Sorry. Okay. I think... maybe radiologists can answer. How to differentiate a simplified chiral pattern and Lissen's cephaly? Either Dr. Asha or Dr. Sneha. Maybe Dr. Asha.
The main thing between the two is the thickness of the cortex. Is what I understand. In simplified gyral pattern, there are less gyri, but the thickness of the cortex is usually more than 3 mm. Sneha, do you have anything more to add?
No, Asha, but I agree that sometimes it can be really difficult, especially with microcephaly. They may be asking about the microcephaly with simplified gyral pattern. Sometimes it is hard to differentiate thin Lissen cephaly with that. But it may be that, you know, Lissen cephaly obviously has a simplified chiral pattern. Cortical thickness is the way to go, but thin Lissen cephalies sometimes are hard to differentiate. But you can always look at the, probably it is not the, it alone may not make a difference. You have other things to go by in further management or diagnostic pathways.
So as clinicians, we understand that the simplified chiral pattern is just one radiological sign, but it's not as hard handle as pachygyria or lissencephaly. Is that right? It is just one imaging finding. In association with other things, probably we need to find some etiology.
It depends on what you call as simplified chiral pattern. So for example, if you look at the thin list, some of the thin list encephalics, I don't know whether Asha showed some of the images. So the thin list encephalies, if the subtle ones are quite difficult to, you know, detect, whereas if it is sometimes you see that the tertiary sulcation is quite less in some random intellectual delay or autism, you'll see that the compared to the normal age and gender, you feel that the tertiary sulcations are less. Those probably does not come into the realm of cortical migrational anomalies. But most of it is black and white. Simplified chiral pattern is a finding, and if it is very subtle, but if it is quite a bad simplified chiral pattern, I think it would also warrant a malformation panel.
Right. And how do you differentiate radiologically cobblestone lissencephaly versus a polymicrogyria, as both can have this bumpy appearance as well as dismyelinated white matter?
Yeah, I think that one of the ways is that usually polymicrogyria is in one particular area, whereas the cobblestone pattern is usually diffuse. But again, that doesn't always hold good. And also the different things that they are associated with. Polymicrogyria is more associated with schizencephalies, and whereas cobblestone pattern is, has other associations like hypomyelination and so on. But again, I think there can be cases where it is difficult to differentiate the two, especially when the polymicrogyria is diffuse. And yes, anything Sneha want to add?
If I may add, I was listening to Dr. Rick Leventer, who's one of the, I think, who has done a lot of work on polymicrogyria in another platform actually this morning. So I think some, like Asha said, some of them are very clear cut, black and white. There is, in some cases, for example, GPR56, they were asking whether is it cobblestone or polymicrogyria, and sometimes it's very hard to differentiate. So what Dr. Leventer was pointing to was GPR56 is closer to the cobblestone causing genes in the pathway and in the function. So he sort of thinks that it could be, it is more like a cobblestone. So I think you do have to look at the pathways, and sometimes it's not possible radiologically to differentiate. And if you know the 2020 malformations white paper, they have clubbed it together saying that polymicrogyria cobblestone complex, so that in the ones where you don't know, it is like, and it probably does not matter whether you identify it or not in some cases. So that is what it is, coming to.
Right. I think in majority of the cases, physicians, that makes us directing investigations towards polymicrogyria panels versus lissencephaly panels. But yeah, as you said, I think things are merging somewhere. Both the group of
and markers. There is also a theory that it is all due to the difference in the gap in the pyrolimiting membrane. Small gaps produce polymicrogyria, and the large gaps produce cobblestone. So I think there are a lot of arguments against it as well. It has not been proven. I understand when clinically you mean that, but cobblestone also has been described in things which go outside the CMDs, isn't it? So I think in CMDs you have other things to clinch the diagnosis, even radiologically. And of course, you have your CK and other things as well. And whereas for things like GPR56, if there is a frontal predominance of your cerebellosis, it does not really matter what you call that, what you call it. As long as you identify the distribution and additional findings, you would still suggest the genetic diagnosis. So sometimes the distinction is not important, but sometimes the distinction is very clear. And so I think that is enough for a practical day-to-day process.
Sure. Question to Dr. Lokesh. So will it be a correct approach to do microarray first and then whole exome sequencing in posterior predominant lissencephaly? And in other types like anterior dominant or diffuse, whole exome would be the first preferred modality to investigate. Is that right approach?
If you are looking at Miller-Dicker because of the dysmorphology with lissencephaly, then probably it is worthwhile to do chromosomal microarray because it's a large deletion. Whereas if it is, there are no dysmorphology suggestive of Miller-Dicker and it's only plain LS1 you are looking at, then probably doing a whole exome is good enough to pick up all the other associated genes as well.
Right. I think in some of the genetic labs, even we have found Miller-Dicker, even though it's a large deletion, of the cases we picked up in exome
as well. I think it might be a better way to do whole exome if you are suspicious, because the chance of picking up other abnormalities is definitely much higher with whole exome.
Yeah.
Unless, I agree with Vivek's point. Yeah.
Yeah. Unless clinically you have very clear that it's likely to be Miller-Dicker.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. Dr. Nitish want to ask a question. Dr. Nitish, you can speak.
Thanks, Ramesh. Thanks, all the panelists. I think excellent presentation. I have a point to make and question to whole panel. So very important point made by all of you is when you find structural malformation in the index case, you always go for genetic testing, for counseling, and of course, then fetal diagnosis. Now, my question is, in a general population where you don't know what's happening to the pregnancy, at specific age with fetal imaging, USG, MRI, I don't know, what can be picked up easily and can that be part of the high-risk babies or high-risk pregnancies? I don't know, what should the strategy? So that's question both clinically as well as radiologically.
Yeah, probably I'll just add to that. Like the yield of genetic testing in many of these cortical malformations and other malformative conditions, probably there will be about 1/3 of cases where you don't know the genetic diagnosis. Because
Ramesh, the data is around 40% you get a genetic 40%. Diagnosis.
Okay, so it's even higher. So 50 to 60% you don't get an answer.
Yes.
So in such cases, I think that Nitish's question is, what are the things that we can pick up, say, before 24 weeks or 28 weeks using imaging during the fetal life? So Dr. Sneha or Dr. Asha, both of you can answer that.
What was the question again? What are the findings in the posterior fossa? Is that the question?
Not generally posterior fossa. Overall, the malformations, CNS malformations, the yield of genetic testing is probably just around 40 to 50% only. So rest, vast majority of cases, we have only imaging to do during the antenatal scans. So what are the abnormalities that can be picked up during fetal? That's the question by Dr. Nitish.
Yeah, I think with imaging, I would prefer for an objective assessment if you have seen. So most often it will be ventriculomegaly, which brings them to higher imaging modalities like MRI. What you can pick up depends upon the age as well as on the the resolution of your images. If you have optimized it quite well and if you have a reasonable experience in imaging, fetal imaging, you will be able to pick up a lot of these cortical malformations, including obviously lissencephaly after an age when the sulcation, depending on the sulcation pattern, polymicrogyria, nodular heterotopias in the posterior fossa, Dandy-Walker malformation, and also what is not Dandy-Walker malformation, the point which I had said about the choroid plexus and the distance between the two can also be picked up in the fetal MRI. So that is another finding which people are now using to differentiate Dandy-Walker malformation from other causes of posterior fossa. There's a couple of good papers that have come out this year. So I think the bottleneck is in getting a very good image and also in acquiring that experience to confidently diagnose most of these things. So you need to see a lot of those because there'll be a lot of practical difficulties. The image quality is one of the most important things, I think. So if someone is doing fetal imaging, I think a lot of time and energy should be invested in optimizing and keep optimizing your sequences. So depending on the gestational age and the image quality and your experience, I think there's a whole lot of things which you can diagnose on fetal imaging. I can't say specifically which ones, but all these cortical malformations, which Asha and Lokesh were describing, has been picked up in fetal imaging.
Okay.
Anything more to add, Asha? Please.
So Dr. Kavita is asking, she's a pediatric neurologist. So as legal age for abortion in India is 20 weeks, which malformations, maybe she wanted to know specifically about the cortical malformations that can be picked up before this age, either using ultrasound or a fetal MRI. Like the major ones, like say carpus callosum agencies, they can be picked up anyway, but among the cortical malformations and maybe other posterior fossa ones, which can be picked up by 20 weeks?
I think picking up cortical malformations before 20 weeks may be difficult because, 20 weeks, we still don't see too many gyri or sulci to start with, especially if it's listened carefully or pachygyri and things like that, which we are looking at. Before 20 weeks will be difficult, at least on ultrasound. But again, I think like Sneha said, fetal imaging is now become a specialty on its own. And there are radiologists who are, at least in India here, who are only doing this. So a lot of it depends on the experience of the radiologists involved. But I think cortical, that's what I feel, that cortical malformations before 20 weeks is going to be difficult. Sneha, you want to add anything on that?
Like you said, I think, unless it is a complete aguria or you see significant micro in the spectrum of microlissencephaly, you see microcephaly or micronencephaly, as well, then it is sometimes difficult, like the thin lissencephalies we were talking about when we discussed the simplified gyral pattern. Those we cannot definitely exclude in the 20, because most of the sulcal development is later. So those cannot be, but if there are other associated findings like a very small brain or large extraaxial spaces, and those kind of things might give you a clue, and there is absolutely no sulcation and the pancake kind of a brain. So there are some things like MOPDs, those can probably be diagnosed, but not the not all of the lissencephaly, because the gyral sulcal development occurs after that. Posterior fossa, definitely you can diagnose some of the Dandy-Walkers and things, and if there is large posterior fossa, those findings will be obvious on the, even on the 20-week scan. So those can be diagnosed, but I think cortical malformations are more difficult to diagnose at the 20-week age.
Next question is, Dr. Shruti is asking this question about asymmetrical ventriculomegaly in fetal ultrasound, which is probably the one we come across most often at 12 weeks ultrasound. And those patients are usually sent to us to clarify whether they should really go for abortion, which is sometimes quickly advised by some doctors, not pediatric neurologists though. And is there any way we can clarify things like, you know, would you always tell them you should have even a mild ventriculomegaly or just asymmetrical ventricular sizes? should they go for a fetal MRI immediately, or how would you go for that? It's just anxious parents wanting to know whether they need to go for an abortion. Asha or Sneha? Hello?
You are muted, Dr. Sneha.
It's more of a clinical or what is practiced where kind of question, isn't it? Because imaging, at that point, if you do, for example, at 12 weeks, if you do an MRI, you're not going to see much more than what you saw on the ultrasound. So at that point, whether to wait is depends on, we'll have to look at the statistics of what happened to ventriculomegalies and according to what is done where kind of question, I think. At 12 weeks, there is no further imaging modality which might help in clarifying it. But if someone is really keen on, you know, having a second look at something more objectively, yes, MRI can be done, but we don't normally do it at that age. So it will usually be around 20 weeks. And if it is outside India, 24 weeks is where we prefer to do the MRI. Because it won't add much more than what you already know on ultrasound.
Because it's a very difficult situation from the parental side as well. Because very often they insist us to give us an answer. And I usually ask for head size measurement on ultrasound to be monitored closely and see how the rest of the bits go. It is a difficult situation. And if anyone else has got any other ideas, clinicians, you can add in as well, please. Lokesh, maybe?
Yeah, I think usually, as Sneha said, a serial monitoring with MRI around 19 to 20 weeks of gestation. If it is bordering towards moderate to severe, that is more than 15 millimeters is obviously severe and they say to terminate. But anything hovering around 10 to 12 millimeters, that's where the dilemma is, whether it's going to increase or it's going to reduce. So as you pointed out well, that if there is a microcephaly with ventriculomegaly, that's a poor combination. There is something significant going on structurally, and maybe you need to be more cautious. But if the head size is proportionate to the other femoral length and abdominal circumference and very mild ventriculomegaly, I think serial follow-up without, in absence of other associated abnormalities of other parts of the body. But if it is going towards 15 millimeters, then you are going to be more cautious, and probably beyond 15 is a term point for termination.
Thank you. But it's a very difficult one, particularly for someone me who is kind of anti-abortion psychologically. So for me to advise someone, it's very difficult. And very often I tell the parents beforehand that I'm anti-abortion and then get on with the consultation. Do you want to still continue with the consultation? I'm sure others would come across such scenarios too.
It's a lot of non-verbal cues they take and they make their mind before what we say.
Well, you are saying that because I'm anti-abortion, I don't even go there. I just tell them, sorry, I will not enter into it. So Dr. Meenakshi Bhatt is one of the people who have been attending all these things. She always says we have to answer it, and I tell her, sorry, can't do it. So I just don't answer.
But at least I'm open with them. That's what I think. I'll be open with them, and I tell them most of the times I'll always advise against abortion, and very difficult dilemma for me. Just the belief and all those things come into the picture as well in this scenario. Okay, shall we just get on into the next one? I think Nitish has asked that question. I think, is there some more questions there before that?
It's a related question. I think related to the previous question only. Sorry. Can you advise to about all cortical malformation that Ranju Agarwal has asked? Just a related question. I think we had discussed that, no? obviously there are a lot of huge spectrum of cortical malformations, clinically, genetically, everything. So we can't put them all in one basket.
But if you look at it, very often there are parents who are looking for a perfect baby, and then anything short of perfection is not acceptable. And when such questions come up, it is very, very difficult to answer. It will very much depend on the parental attitude. Whatever we say can be taken in different ways. And what I would feel very sad is a well-grown, well baby who could easily have been aborted and lost. So that's a thing to consider depending on how the parents look at it. Shall we move to the next question?
Yes.
Ramesh?
Yeah, yeah.
From Raj, it's complimenting all the speakers. Usually we are investigating the etiology for our children with neurological cases. We get satisfied when we get a structural malformation to explain all the features. And then the genetic analysis which comes on. And so the question is, which features would point us more in favor of genetic analysis, particularly considering recurrence and genetic counseling, where risks are more than general population risk? So I think the question is, when should you go for genetic analysis when you see a structural malformation?
I think all cases of structural, unless you are looking at an acquired cause of structural brain abnormality, if you are looking at all structural cortical malformations, tubulinopathies, or whatever we discussed today, there is a role for genetic analysis. Thankfully, the risk of recurrence, because most of them are de novo, as we discussed, including lissencephaly pattern, but except for something like Miller-Dicker, where there is a reciprocal balance translocation is there in around 12%. But other ones, and also in tubulinopathy, only one form of tubulinopathy, TUB8, where is the autosomal recessive inheritance. 95% of them are de novo. So the risk of recurrence is incidence of around germline mosaicism, where the geneticists put the recurrence risk anywhere between 1 to 5%. So thankfully, the risk of recurrence baseline is extremely low, even if the first child has this one. But we can find answer in 40, maybe up to 50% of cases with the genetics, which will make our life easier for the counseling for next pregnancy.
Yes, I think that would be, and can I just, I think there's a question coming back on, think about the burden on the parents if a disabled baby is born. I think I would find it very difficult to answer. I'd probably keep my mouth shut at this point. Perhaps Lokesh could discuss.
Sorry,
this.
I didn't get that.
Lokesh, it was coming up about looking at the subtle abnormalities, which you can see something like asymmetric ventriculomegaly on 12 weeks gestation, and yeah. Then ask advising on particularly people like me who are anti-abortion thinking fellows.
No, I think it has to be practical. 12 weeks is too early to predict too many things. Yeah. We'll have to serially follow up. We have time until 20 weeks. You serially follow up. Many of them do regress. The ventricular size come back to normal. So it's too early. You don't have to take a decision at that point. We would advise serial ultrasounds every 2 weeks or 4 weeks. And then catch up. And if it is going towards the way where we discussed, if it is significant ventriculomegaly, progressive cortical thinning, then you say, yes, don't continue. But if it is not, and if it is stabilizing over 8 weeks, is a very good time to follow them up. It will give us a trend, and that if it is stabilizing or regressing, you are fine. You have to continue this.
In my experience, they haven't come back to me when I have given them a very clear thing of what they should be looking for.
Yeah. Having said that, I have to bite my fingers because we counseled around 26 weeker with asymmetric ventriculomegaly. It's just a mild ventriculomegaly. They might have mild hemiparesis. Rest should be fine. And the child now has refractory epileptic spasms and cognitive issues secondary to COL4A1 mutation.
My goodness.
So the child had intraventricular hemorrhage, mild asymmetric ventriculomegaly, and that is what the status is now 3 years. So it's extremely challenging sometimes. So you'll have to put that things out in there that yes, it's only can concern about structural thing. What is underlying genetic basis, we wouldn't know. So the outcomes is definitely not as straightforward.
I also add in that even a lot of children with completely normal looking scans can
have
significant problems. And that is not something we can predict through. So try to be as possible. I myself have one question for Sneha. One of the things we come across is when to look for metabolic problems when you have a cerebellar hypoplasia. So when you have cerebellar hypoplasia, it's like easy to go for the genes. And one of the questions which come up from time to time is there a metabolic cause for it? And is there any clues in the radiology that would help us? It's probably getting too late for Sneha. Sorry.
I don't think so that there is anything specifically radiological unless there are other findings. So if it is just a global hypoplasia, I don't think we can. By looking at the cerebellum, I don't think we can diagnose any metabolic causes. If it's an isolated cerebellar hypoplasia or atrophy, I think radiologically there is nothing more that we can help. Then the only way is to take the inventory of the non-infrapretentorial or other findings and see if there are any clues. So,
thanks, Nia. I don't think we've got any more questions there. Let me just check the chat box.
Are all done.
Sorry. Can you take them on, please, Amish?
No, they're all done. So all questions are done. Thank you all the three speakers, Dr. Sneha, Dr. Lokesh, and Dr. Asha Thomas for the wonderful talks. And we enjoyed it as neurologists, and the questions reflect how much the audience were engaged. Thank you very much. Dr. Ann, over to you.
Just wanted to say a quick vote of thanks. Thank you to our fantastic moderators, Dr. Ramesh and Dr. Vail, and to our speakers, and ORDI and AOCN. So thank you so much. This was a very nice interactive session for us, mainly because neuroradiology is something that we work with always and we learn all the time. And I think it is a two-way street. And this is something that I understand always. It's a privilege working with Dr. Asha. So I do feel partial about it because I work with her. But other than that, we are coming to the end of our series, the 15-week series. So please log in for our last session. We've got really good speakers, Dr. Renu Sutar, Siddharth Shah, and Dr. Prasad Hanagandi. Bye-bye. Have a nice weekend.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye, everyone.